It's really interesting, Governor, because the process you just described of an open process where members of Congress put forth their suggestions on how to spend money, have them voted on individually, is exactly how the process worked. So what you're just suggested as to how earmarks should work in the future is exactly how they worked in the past. So I suspect you would have supported earmarks if you were in the United States Senate.
I'm sorry, the 6,000 earmarks that were put in place under the Speaker's term, for instance, were oftentimes tagged onto other bills. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be critical. That was the process. There were thousands. I mean, we've had thousands and thousands of earmarks. They are typically tagged onto, bundled onto other bills. Okay, go ahead,
Mr. Speaker.
You're entitled to your opinions, Mitch. You're not entitled to the. You know,
I've heard that line before.
The facts, yeah, and you're misrepresenting the facts. You don't know what you're talking about. What happened in the earmark process? What happens in the earmark process? It was that members of Congress would ask, formally, publicly request these things, put them on paper, and have them allocated, and have them voted on in committee, have them voted on the floor of the Senate.
Congressman Paul,
as part of the bill,
and the President can't veto it.
He can veto the bill.
The whole bill, but he can't veto the earmark.
Well, we tried to do that, by the way. I supported the line item veto.
That's what I support.
Hold on. Nick, I agree with you. I support the line item veto. I voted for a line item veto so we could do just that. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court struck it down. I would like to go back as president again and give the president the authority to line item veto. But that's not the issue. The issue is, were they transparent? And the bottom line was, when I was in the United States Senate, there was transparency, and Congressman Paul, who is one of the most prolific earmarksers in the Congress today, would tell you, and I'm not criticizing, I'm just saying that that's a fact,
Mr. Speaker, you were referenced by the governor. You first, then Congressman Paul. Don't worry, we'll get to you, Congressman, I promise.
Let me just say flatly, all of you need to think about this, because this is one of those easy demagogic fights that gets you in a lot of trouble. If you have Barack Obama as president and you have a Republican House, you may want the House imposing certain things on the president. Now, when I was Speaker, for example, and we had a liberal Democrat in the White House, I actually want to reinforce what the governor said. I helped the Atlanta Olympics get the support they needed from the U.S. government to be successful. I thought it was totally appropriate to help the Atlanta Olympics, and I actually went to your former governor and sat down with the people originally planning the Winter Olympics and said, look, this is what we did. This is what you need to do. I think it was totally appropriate for you to ask for what you got. I just think it's kind of silly for you to then turn around and run an ad attacking somebody else for getting what you got and then claiming what you got wasn't what they got because what you got was right and what they got was wrong.
Congressman Paul, answer Senator Santorum, please, sir.
I followed that. And I you know, there's reason for the confusion because it's all Congress's fault. They're all messed up. They don't know what they're doing in Congress is the real reason. But this whole idea of earmarking is designating how the money is spent. What a lot of people don't understand is if the Congress doesn't say the way the money should be spent, it goes to the executive branch. And that's the bad part. If you were actually cutting, it would make a difference. But you don't want to give more power to the executive branch. Even if I'm president, I don't want more power over that funding. That should be with the people and with the Congress. But earmarking... The reason we get into trouble is the irresponsibility of Congress. Take your highway funds. We're supposed to pay a user fee. We pay our gasoline tax. We should get our fair share back. But what do? They take the highway funds and other these trust funds, and they spend this money overseas in these wars that we shouldn't be fighting. And then when the highways need building, then you have to go and fight the political system and know who to deal with and maneuver and try to get some of your money back. But if you say you're against the earmarking and fuss and fume over, the answer is vote against the bill. That is what I do. I argue for the case of the responsibility being on the Congress, but it's the responsibility of us who believe in fiscal conservatism to vote against the bill. We need a vote against the spending is what we need to do.
All right. Let's take another important economic question. This